Well, the United States is imposing sanctions on Iran after the Trump administration announced earlier this year our exit from the Iran nuclear deal. But the move is getting pushback. The president this morning called the sanctions the most biting ever imposed and warned against anyone doing business with Iran. But the move is creating a deep divide with European allies who supported the Iran nuclear deal. The EU foreign policy chief, along with France, Germany, and UK foreign ministers, are pledging to protect firms that do business with Iran from the impact of U.S. sanctions. National Security Advisor John Bolton dismissed the idea of countries finding a way around.
We think the sanctions that went into effect at midnight actually began to have an effect back in May when the president pulled out of the wretched Iran nuclear deal because many businesses around the world didn't want to risk losing business in the United States in order to continue to do business with Iran. So the implications are already pretty profound.
Joining me now, Anita Kumar. She's the White House correspondent for McClatchy. Anita, so great to have you on set.
Yeah, thanks. It's nice to be in New York.
Yes, exactly. So tell me about this first round of sanctions. What can we really expect?
Well, it's not unexpected, right? As you noted, the United States pulled out of the nuclear deal in May, so we knew this was coming. We just didn't know exactly when. We expect a second set in November. So this is exactly what the president said he was going to do. People are still pushing back against it, but it's not surprising at all. The question is how detrimental will it be to Iran?
Is there a way to gauge that at this point, Anita?
No, I think it's still just happening. But remember, this was pre-Obama we could have a sense of how things were going before he lifted the sanctions. And obviously, this was a problem for their economy. Mm-hmm. So we expect it to be again.
You know, it's interesting. We've heard Senator Lindsey Graham, who is very familiar with foreign policy and also Middle East issues, come out forward saying we want regime change in Iran. John Bolton came out and said, no, actually, that's not the, right. the path we're going down. What do you see happening here as far as the administration's
policy? Well, they've actually, like many things, said different things. So we've heard that. We've heard, you know, all sorts of things. At one point, we were told that we want to have a new nuclear deal, right? One that's better. The president often talks about how it's a bad deal and he's going to renegotiate it. This is a sign, I don't think, that they were trying to renegotiate it. They're moving on with sanctions and they're saying that they're out.
You know, the president has said he's willing to sit down with anyone, including Iran. The Iranians have sort of rebuffed that. You know, from what we've seen with the economy at this point, do you get the sense that they might actually sit down with Donald Trump? And is there optimism for the White House? Are they interested in that?
I think the president means it when he says he'd meet with anyone. Look at the last two meetings he had, right? Vladimir Putin of Russia, which he got a ton of pushback about, and also Chairman Kim of North Korea. A lot of pushback on that. So I think he'd be willing to do it. I think he kind of just said that, and I'm not sure that was something that was discussed within the administration, much like, you know, that's often how he works. He just kind of says things, and they have to deal with it afterwards. So I think he'd be willing to do that, but I don't know that they want to do that, either side, until they come up with some. They don't even have a goal right now. What would be the next step, right? We've pulled out. We have the sanctions. There's not really something to negotiate at the moment.
You know, even though the U.S. pulled out of the Iran nuclear deal, our European allies have said we're going to still uphold what we agreed mm-hmm. to, which includes doing business. Do you think that ultimately it's going to take the wind out of these sanctions if our European allies are saying we're not going to play ball with the U.S. on this?
Yeah, I mean, definitely. The United States would like Europe to go along with them, right? What it is doing is creating more friction between the United States and European leaders. You know, we've seen this over and over. Every meeting, the NATO meeting that just happened, the G7 meeting, we've seen that Donald Trump has said things that have basically angered the European leaders, and this is no different. Again, they knew it was coming, so it wasn't unexpected, but they still don't like it.
I want to take a closer look back here at home. There are several states holding special primaries today for midterm elections, and there's one that's a focus, a special congressional race seat in Ohio. What's the White House saying about this, and are they worried that if they don't win this seat, that even if it's a close margin, that this could be a loss for the White House?
Right. So even if the Republican wins and it's close and it's looking like it will be close, that is clearly it's not a loss for them, but it's going to shake them a little bit. So there's been a few races. We have a lot of primaries going on, but this is a special election. So whoever wins a congressional seat, Democrat versus Republican. We've seen several of those over the last 18 months since Donald Trump's been president, and it's all very familiar. It's a Republican, sometimes more of a Trump person, sometimes more of an establishment candidate, versus a very, you know, young, fresh-faced, new Democrat who's decided that they want Iran. That's exactly what's happening here. The question will be, is Donald Trump's endorsement good or bad? So Donald Trump was there just a couple days ago. The vice president was there a couple days ago. The president tweeted about him. They're really putting their all behind him. And the question is, you know, is the Democrat going to win, which would be huge after decades of having a Republican there? Or is he even going to get close?
I want to ask about your own reporting. You're looking at sort of fundraising, and the president, you know, has been tweeting and holding these rallies and going around the country. But you found, and you wrote in your article today, his fundraising since taking office, nearly half has actually been for himself, raising money for his own campaign coffers. Can you sort of put this into context for us? How unusual is that for a sitting president to sort of bank that much money? And what are we seeing differently here?
Yeah, so it's really different, actually. So we looked back and got some research that said in the modern era, whatever that is, since Jimmy Carter, every president that since then has only started fundraising for themselves, for their reelection, in their third year. So here we are in their second year of the presidency. Donald Trump started fundraising for himself on day one. So when he was inaugurated on January 20th last year, he announced that he was going to run for reelection, and he basically, that allowed him to start collecting money. So if you wanted to write a check for Donald Trump's campaign, you could. But more importantly, he started holding fundraisers for himself. Now, he is doing other fundraisers for other people, candidates, and also the Republican Party. So it's not solely for him, but usually $0 are raised in the first 2 years for a reelection. So it's very unusual.
And he is a great fundraiser. I mean, he has really raised great money for the RNC. It's not that
record,
he hasn't.
Record-breaking. So he is helping out his party. But what this really shows is, actually, there was one other interesting point of that, is he's actually held less fundraisers than most presidents. So less fundraisers and more for himself. So that means he's doing less for the party. They are doing well. So there's no one saying that they're not. The party's doing well. But it's just different. It's very different perspective, and it shows that he's more for himself than he is for his party.
As you know, Anita, money is a huge lifeline in politics. Do you get the sense that as you look out across the midterm landscape, both congressional, state seats, are people concerned that they don't have enough money? Or how do you think that the fact that he's sort of lining his own personal coffers, his campaign coffers, how could that translate down come November?
Well, it could translate down that the party doesn't have enough money. We don't know that yet. They're still doing fine. And remember, it's not just the RNC, so it's the committee that deals with, the House and the Senate. So all of those parties need money. But, you know, this, even if the Republican Party gets money, this helps them in 2020 because they're the ones out there doing field work and getting people motivated in individual districts. I haven't really heard anyone complaining they don't have money. Seems like there's always a lot of money. You know, we talked about the Ohio race. The Democrat actually raised a ton of money in this particular race, but the Republican Party has helped the Republican candidate. So I think it's politics. There's a lot of money to go around.
It certainly seems that way. Anita Kumar, thank you so much for joining us.